All right, let's learn or maybe relearn as psychologists about functional analysis. We've probably heard about it as psychologists at some point in our academic lives. So it's based on a simple premise. You have some fundamental parameters of your system that usually you're trying to guess, and they have some sort of dimension associated with them. If you combine them in such a way that they become dimensionless, then you might learn something really interesting about your system. For example, how it scales across many different orders of magnitude. It's an approximate tool, but it can be a very useful and powerful approximate tool. For example, one of the most famous examples is what G.I. Taylor did to release photographs of the first atomic bomb blast back in 1947 that were just declassified by the U.S. government. With nothing more than a few photographs, he was able to infer the energy of the bomb. And the government, shortly after, declassified that information because he got so close. So an approximate tool, but a powerful tool. To put it another way, you could ask, what is this? Well, what it's not is a cat. If it were a cat, it would have a mouth. But it's not a cat. But if you're standing 100 meters away, it probably doesn't matter. It's a pretty good approximation. So let's take a look at how this has been used in 21st century in marketing. I study hyperbaric exchange, like Adam. It's nothing more than the exchange of water and nutrients between a river with a river's water column and stuff on the side of a river. So we have to idealize this in some way in order to get something useful that we can model. So usually what we do is we treat the subsurface and all that stuff underneath as just this low-mix pool. And once we have this conceptualization, we can associate a scale with it. So here's the residence time associated with this pool, the amount of time that a particle will spend in there before it wants to leave. Great, we got scale. Let's see what we can do with all of our different measurements across the range of these scales. And scientists did this back in 2007. They figured out that some really interesting predictive relationships exist if you just look at nothing more than like the width to the height ratio or the sinuosity of the river. So awesome, we have this really powerful tool, perhaps, to approximate all these scales. Why do we even care about the math and the physics? We just use it all the time. Well, let's take a look at what it might not be. Say, for example, that all of the people in the pool are pollutants, and you really care if they're all gone. We want to measure time scale, right? We want to measure how long they're spending there on average. So you're observing after an hour, a few will disappear. After a little bit more time, a few more disappear. But what if that guy on the left just sticks around forever? Well, by the time the experiment's over, he's still there. You're going to basically have to conclude that there is no characteristic time scale. The mean time based on him sticking around is going to be infinity. It turns out that this is pretty common in nature. We try to affix a scale to something when really we're integrating over a number of different scales, a number of different really complicated processes. So oftentimes it's a good approximation, and oftentimes it's not a good approximation, depending on what we're really interested in. Luckily, there's some new tools that are being developed that can relax our assumption about the characteristic time scale. Instead of inferring something deterministic and fixed, we can assign a range of time scales to our model without completely busting our model. If you're interested in hearing a little bit more, I'd be happy to talk to you about it. Anyway, in a nutshell, consider your characteristic times or whatever characteristic scales you're interested in. It can teach you a lot about your system, but if there doesn't seem to be a characteristic scale, you might still learn a lot about your system.